So I think the hardest part every single day waking up is trying to decide, you know, which blue quarter zip I'm gonna wear today and which set of sweatpants. But we're getting there. I talked to some of my colleagues and, you know, they're scared as well.
It's biology.
But we're trying to make sense out of this remote learning as best we can. They look outside, you know, I see the parks are closed. Not a lot of people are out. It's a lot to take in. And I hope you guys are happy and healthy and doing some of your work at the very least. But I digress, and we must move on to remote learning.
So, what would you little maniacs like to do first?
Watching through our fingers, watching through our fingers.
Shuts my eyes and count to ten. It goes in one ear, out the other, one ear, out the other. Burning bright right till the end. Now you'll be missing from the photographs, missing from the photographs.
Okay, so this is Introduction to Balancing Chemical Equations, and this is basically just taken from that very first worksheet I gave you guys. So what I have right here is supposed to be representing of two carbons, and then we've got six hydrogens around the outside, which on the sheet is just referring to C2H6. And so C2H6 for us, or ethane, is going to react with oxygen, in this case, O2. And so if we look at this, and we're trying to balance this chemical equation out, here's our actual reactants that it's giving us in the problem. And we know the products that's going to happen is that these two are basically going to hit each other and sort of break into individual pieces. Now that's slightly a lie, and it's not exactly the truth, but we can imagine as we went up the reaction energy curve that this could happen. And then if we look at this, then the products that are actually going to form, well, one of them is H2O, so two H's and an O, water. And another product is carbon dioxide, so CO. And then we have a problem, because we have a bunch of extra pieces that didn't get used up, and we actually have an incomplete product that formed as well.
What?
And so you can see that we don't have enough of everything. And so initially I look at this and say, well, I don't have enough oxygens. So let's add in some more oxygens. And in this case, oxygens come in packages of two.
Oh, all right.
So I put another oxygen inside of there. Now if I'm gonna do this, I need to denote it with a coefficient. So now that would react this with two O2s. So I can break this one apart again through the process of collision theory or a reaction, and we can make my CO2. But again, we still have a problem, because now I can make, yes, another water, but I'm still left with some pieces that still haven't reacted yet. And so you'll say, well, I need to have a CO2, so let's add in another oxygen, break that apart, build this up and get another CO2, but I still have some reactants left over. Now, keeping in mind, if we do this, I've now added a total of three O2s and one C2H6. And I've made two waters and two CO2s, but I still have some pieces that haven't balanced out. Well, the law of conservation of mass says you cannot create or destroy matter. So basically, what's happening here is we have an issue where we have some matter that's disappearing. We have some matter that's not showing up on the other side. And so we need to keep at this adding process to try and figure out, well, how can I get all the pieces to show up? And of course, you'll see, well, eventually I need more carbons. So carbons come in packages of C2H6. And so we can break these up and form our brand new products. But again, you'll see very quickly that we're gonna have another issue. Once again, now there's not enough oxygens. So I've added a second C2H6. Let's try and go to another set of oxygens. So now I've added a total of 4 oxygens added. Oxygen comes in, breaks apart. We can then, of course, make a CO2. And we still have an unbalanced reaction. So let's go to 5 oxygens. Here's my 5th oxygen. I could again make a CO2. And I still am not yet satisfied yet. So I keep making more products. Now a 6th oxygen comes into play here. With that 6th oxygen coming in, we can then break that apart and start making some waters to get rid of some of these H's. So there's an H2O. Here's another H2O. And I'm slowly accumulating my products. But again, 6 is not enough. So let's try a 7th O2. And if that's the case with my 7th O2, you can imagine that one coming into play here. And we would have, of course, yet another O2 coming in, breaking apart, and making finally enough products where all of the reactants are getting used up. And now we've taken all of our reactants and turned them into products. And what we've seen along the process is that 2 C2H6s needed to react with 7 O2s to make a total of 6 waters and 4 CO2s. We have C2H6 reacting with O2. So these would represent oxygen atoms in red. We've got our carbons in black and our hydrogens in yellow. We also know from this given reaction that we already know what the products should be. Our products for this reaction should end up being water and CO2. And so if that's the case, we have to look at this and say, okay, how on earth can we take C2H6, react it with oxygen, and break all these pieces up to make, like this is saying, these two things? And you'll quickly realize I only have 2 hydrogens on my product side. I somehow have 3 oxygens, even though I only started with 2, and I lost a carbon along the way. I did not verify any of the law of conservation of mass as this went through. And so I'm gonna use this kind of as sort of our basis to sort of, like, how do we write this out? How do we do this in a way that's easier for us to read and can't kind of keep track of the pieces? I have C2H6 reacting with oxygen to produce CO2 and H2O. And that's our actual overall reaction. But what we have to realize is our reactants, in this case C2H6 and O2, are going to be forming brand new things, carbon dioxide and water. All we have to keep track of is the matter, because whatever's on our reactant side better show up on our product side. That's what the law of conservation of mass is actually stating. And so we can kind of keep track of that by almost just sort of looking at the various types of elements. So on my reactant side, I have carbons, I have hydrogens, and I have oxygens. So no matter what happens throughout this reaction, I better have those exact same things, carbon, hydrogens, and oxygens. And so now all I'm gonna do is I'm basically gonna count these out. On my reactant side, I have a total of 2 carbons. I have 6 hydrogens, and I have 2 oxygens. On my product side, I gotta be a little careful here. I have 1 carbon, I have 2 hydrogens, but my oxygens are actually in 2 locations. So I really have 2 plus 1 oxygens, or a total of 3. You're gonna see me do this because this is basically saying to myself, save this one for last because it's going to be a problem. Okay, so let's start by balancing the carbons out. If I wanna have 2 carbons on this side, I would need to multiply the entire CO2 by 2. because you cannot change these little numbers called subscripts. Those are what actually stand for the atoms bonded. If we start changing the little numbers around, we start changing the molecule in its entirety. Two CO2s just means I have two of these, and that's called a coefficient. Now if I do that, I not only change the carbon to two, but I also change this other oxygen to four. But like I said before, this will take care of itself if we sort of wait. So now my carbons are balanced on both sides. I have two carbons in my reactants, two carbons in my products. Hydrogens. Okay, I have six on the left, two on the right. And so if you're quick, you'd be like, okay, mathematically, I'm going to multiply the waters by three. That would change this to six. It would also change this oxygen over here to three, making my total seven. So now my carbons and my hydrogens are both balanced on both sides. The big problem is, how do you get the oxygens to line up? And so here's where the trick is. One option would be to say, let's take everything and multiply the entirety of what we have by two. Another option would be to say, well, what can I multiply two by to get seven? And if you're good with fractions, you'll see from this worksheet, you would just multiply it by 7/2. That's a little bit tricky to see. And for the most time, kids don't like doing this. Kids don't see it, but it makes balancing this really, really easy. The other problem is you cannot leave that, because there's no such thing as 7/2 of an oxygen molecule. You cannot have a half. So what I said originally was, let's just take what we already have and let's just change our coefficients so that we have the same ratio. But in this case, let's make two of everything. So I have two C2H6s. This would change to four and this would change to six. Now if we do that, this changes to four. This still says four. Our hydrogens here would change to 12. Our hydrogens here would still be 12, so we're still good. What it does to my oxygens, and of course we're ignoring the 7/2, is I have two sitting on this side, but on my product side, I have 4 times 2, or 8, and then 6 times 1, plus 6, which would be a total of 14. Well, instead of having two, what do you multiply by to get 14? The answer is 7. So the number right there should end up being 7, and that's how we have an overall balanced equation. Most of the time when you do this, you'll see me go from left to right, one atom at a time. Let me show you really quickly what I mean by that. The long way would be to take this and look at every individual atom one at a time. The faster method would be to say, let's look at one atom at a time on my reactant side and see what happens. So I have two carbons on the left. I would like to have two carbons on the right. So I put a 2 in front. Now yes, that's messing up my oxygen, but I'm going to ignore it because I'm going to go one atom at a time. Six oxygens on the left, six oxygens on the right by adding a 3. Now we have a problem with our oxygens. So over here I have 4 oxygens plus 3, or 7. There's nothing I can multiply by 2 to get 7. So because of that, I'm going to say, well, let's scratch what we have and start with everything going to a factor of 2. So I have 2 of these, I have 4 of these, and I have 6 of these. So now my carbons are still 4, my hydrogens are still 12, and what happens with my oxygens is this switches to 8, this switches to 6. 8 plus 6 is 14, this ends up being 7, and there's our overall balanced chemical equation, which tells us that we need a total of 2 C2H6s, 7 oxygens, and then we'll end up creating our 4 CO2s and 6 H2Os, which would end up balancing the overall chemical equation. This just takes practice.
Every minute and every hour, I miss you, I miss you, I miss you more. Every stumble and each misfire, I miss you, I miss you, I miss you.